Good morning, everybody, and welcome to yet another exciting Gairdner Symposium day, 2 days of exciting science. Now, every year, the Gairdner Symposium and the awards to the Gairdner International and Global Health and Whiteman Awards are really the highlight of the academic year here at University of Toronto, she says, putting on her University of Toronto hat. I'm Janet Rossand, and I'm actually here in my role as President and Scientific Director of the Gairdner Foundation. My first year on the job, and I must say, it's a fantastic job. You get to meet amazing people, you hear about great science, and you really look at how we can use our understanding of science to influence the next generation of scientists, many of whom are sitting in the audience today. So I'm not going to spend a long time up here. I just really want to welcome you all and to say that what the order of business today is you're going to hear from all of our 7 Gairdner awardees during the day, and they're going to tell you about their science and about their sort of journey to the award, the research that led to the award, and probably some of the issues and the impact of those discoveries. And then tomorrow, we're going to pick up on one of the major themes of today, which is, of course, CRISPR-Cas. And we're going to just have some more talks about a broader impact of genome editing, its applications, and also some of the ethical issues. So I really encourage all of you to consider this as a 2-day symposium. Take your seats today and save your seat for tomorrow. Come back, because we're going to have another great day of science. We'll finish off the day tomorrow with a discussion with as many of the speakers as we can keep around and talk about the implications of the kind of science that's going on today. So really, here we are. It's a great day. I want to extend my congratulations once more to all the awardees, but you'll have a chance to do that yourself. And I'm going to now introduce Trevor Young, who is the Dean of the Faculty of Medicine here at University of Toronto. So the university has been a great partner for the Gairdner Foundation over many years and really hosts our talks here and provides the auditorium and everything else we need. And Trevor will be chairing this morning's session. Trevor.
Well, thank you, Janet, for the introduction and, of course, your leadership in your new role for the Gairdner Foundation. It's a great privilege to host the winners of the Canada Gairdner Awards each year at the University of Toronto and to have the symposium here in this auditorium. It gives us an opportunity to hear from some of the world's most accomplished medical researchers, and this year is no exception. So I'd like to welcome today's distinguished speakers to University of Toronto, and I'd also like to welcome all of you here to the McLeod Auditorium, as well as those who are watching the program online. You are in for a real treat this year, like other years, hearing about some of the ways that science has influenced us in such a positive way. We begin this morning by hearing from Professor Rodolphe Barrangou of the North Carolina State University and Dr. Philippe Horvath, a senior scientist at DuPont. They are co-winners of the Canada Gairdner International Award in recognition of the work that has established and characterized the CRISPR-Cas bacterial immune defense system. Their seminal 2007 paper in Science showed that CRISPR is an adaptive immune system that can acquire genetic snapshots of bacterial virus attacks. That insight has led to the development of new gene editing and gene therapy techniques. Professor Barrangou earned his bachelor's degree in biological sciences from the René Descartes University in Paris, France, the master's degree at the University of Technology in Compiègne, France, a master's degree and Ph.D. in genomics at North Carolina State, and an MBA from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He's associate professor in the Department of Food, Bioprocessing, and Nutritional Sciences, and the Todd R. Klaenhammer Distinguished Scholar in Probiotics Research at North Carolina State. Dr. Horvath graduated from the University Louis Pasteur in Strasbourg, France, obtained his Ph.D. in cellular and molecular biology there as well. He is a senior scientist at DuPont, an associate to the DuPont's Fellows Forum, and was named the DuPont Nutrition Health Technical Fellow in 2015. So I'd like to welcome both Professors Barrangou and Horvath to the stage. Thank you.
So it's a distinct pleasure and a tremendous honor for me to be here today. I am a bit lacking words to say how thankful I am to the Gairdner Foundation and all the people involved in the nomination and selection process for their wise choice to include me as a Gairdner laureate. I know it happens only once in a lifetime, and perhaps this is the best thing that has happened in my professional career. Also, I am especially delighted to open this series of presentations, as I am among this year's Gairdner laureates, the first to have been working on CRISPR. Indeed, back in 2002, I was a junior scientist at Rodia Food in France, and I had the luck to be sent to a congress on lactic acid bacteria, where I discovered CRISPR through a poster presented by the French team at INRA. So I take this opportunity also to give a message to my supervisors at DuPont. It is critical for us scientists to go to congresses because sometimes we bring back some valuable information. So this is the end of the message. In 2003, I realized that a colleague working at Rodia Food in Madison, Wisconsin, was also considering CRISPR for other purposes. And his name was Mike Russell, working in the team of Dennis Romero. Dennis is here today. Hello, Dennis. And Mike decided to leave the company in 2005, but fortunately, to replace him, we hired Rodolphe, and this has been a very decisive addition to the team. And because most of what we did was done together, what we did on CRISPR, we have elected today to give a combined presentation, and this is also a great honor for me.
Indeed, good morning, everyone. It is our great pleasure to open the series of talks we get today. It's a tremendous honor, and we are quite excited to do a first for the Gairdner Foundation. We indeed are going to co-deliver a talk on discoveries and work and collaborative efforts that we have worked on for the past 12 years. So I think this is a great way to kick off the day today, and we quite look forward to sharing the story and the stories behind the discoveries that we've done for which we'll be recognized today. So there's a series of things we want to do today, and what we're going to do is first make sure we all start on the same page and understand what the CRISPR basics are and what they were before they became everything you know about genome editing. Once we're all on the same page, we'll walk you through the much longer history of CRISPR-Cas biology, and we'll go through the various stages and discoveries that have enabled the community and many of the scientists you'll hear from today and tomorrow, which is going to be back tomorrow, to hear about what has happened over the course of time. And then we will go through a series of applications that have built up to the genome editing revolution, and then in the end provide you our perspective on what we call the past CRISPR decades.
So, to start with some basics about CRISPR. CRISPR is first an acronym for DNA repeats that have been found in bacterial genome. So it's not a tool for genome editing, also, although now this is a keyword used for genome editing. It designs DNA repeat, and here on the screen you have a nice CRISPR locus. Can you see it? No? So I will help you. All those letters in bold are actually DNA repeats that are all identical to the others. They are short in length and separated by short sequences called spacers that are all unique, meaning that every spacer in a CRISPR array is generally unique in sequence. So we usually represent those arrays as this here, with black diamonds corresponding to the repeats, and the white rectangles corresponding to the spacers. Those arrays, CRISPR arrays, are associated to Cas genes. They have been named like this because they coded for proteins of unknown function. So it's just because they are on one side or on both sides of the CRISPR array that this Cas name has been given.
And indeed, as you will hear over the next 2 days, CRISPR is not just a one-piece equation. There's CRISPR-Cas system. And it's not just the famous and popular and infamous and convenient and portable and wonderful type 2 system molecular machine that you may be familiar with, but there's actually multiple classes of CRISPR-Cas immune system, class 1, class 2, and major types, notably type 1, the infamous type 2, and the type 3. And this contributes to the unappreciated and maybe unearthed complexity and diversity of those beautiful molecular machines that are there. And they share common idiosyncrasies that we'll walk you through there. DNA encoded, RNA mediated, nucleic acid targeting machines. But the way they go about doing this varies widely over the course of nature.
So despite the fact that there are multiple systems with huge variations in terms of Cas gene content or effectors that are involved, this is a very basic view of the mechanism of action. So it starts, it can be divided into two main stages. One has been called adaptation. And I like to use the term immunization because it's really what happens to the bacterial cell. So you have here a bacterial cell which is infected by a virus, for instance. And some Cas proteins are able to detect this presence of foreign DNA. In order to extract, to cleave a piece of this DNA in order to integrate it into the CRISPR array. So this insertion comes with a duplication of one repeat, generally the first repeat, which is located close to the leader sequence.
And much like in any adaptive immune system you may be familiar with, there is one step of vaccination, of adaptation, of acquisition of invasive genetic elements. And once you're vaccinated, you need to express immunity. And the way CRISPR-Cas systems express immunity in a very cursory way is first by transcription of the CRISPR array into a full-length pre-CRISPR RNA transcript, which, as you will hear later today, gets processed into small interfering CRISPR RNAs that then guide the Cas machinery, the Cas nucleases, the Cas proteins for sequence-specific targeting and cleavage of the complementary sequence and of the invasive nucleic acid. And we'll walk you through the many discoveries that enable us and others to establish CRISPR-Cas as adaptive immune systems in bacteria. So we're now going to go through the history and then walk you through the various stages, the various eras of time that have enabled scientists over the past 20-ish years to characterize those CRISPR-Cas systems.
Yeah, so CRISPR was not born 3 or 4 years ago. Actually, it has already almost 30 years of history. So we decided to use this timeline that was published in a 2014 review, which shows many of the critical discoveries and when they happened. And we decided to use this classification delineation in time. So this is very personal, but it's not official, but we like it. And so we will use this cursor in order for you to see when the things happened.
So the story, the history of CRISPR actually starts all the way back to 1987. As Philippe just said, maybe 30 years ago, right? And there was a group in Japan, you know, there's a lot of very good Japanese scientists, many of which have been heavily recognized for the Gairdner Foundation and others. And they were sequencing, like many scientists did in the 1980s, small scale pieces of DNA in the genome of E. coli K12. And at one point in their analysis of the IAP gene, in a non-coding region immediately adjacent to to that gene, they noticed, they observed, and they sequenced this very peculiar set of DNA repeats, which, as Philippe just mentioned, are clustered, or they're clustered together in the genome, regularly interface with this periodicity short, with the 31 to 36 nucleotides, partially palindromic, because the 5 prime DNA is reversed up under 3 prime DNA repeat. They didn't give them a name, they didn't give them a function, but they remained to this day the first group that ever noticed, observed, and sequenced CRISPR-Cas system.
And what's interesting here is that this group published a second paper 2 years later, indicating that they saw something interesting. They wanted to obtain a function, but they failed to provide any explanation for the presence of those repeats.
And you have to wait for a few years in the early 1990s for scientists to actually start exploiting those sequences for a particular application. And because some of those sequences are hypervariable and they are very unique and they are distinguished and distinct between different strains that are closely related within the same species, but the first application was to use these DNA polymorphism as a novel genotyping, like a DNA, unique DNA fingerprinting technology to look at human pathogens. Which means that actually CRISPR-Cas systems, in some ways, have been used and applied in some medical applications all the way since 1993.
So then in 1995, the Spanish group of Francisco Morica, who was sequencing a lot of bacterial genomes, so that those sequences were present in most of those genomes, and they provided first hypotheses about the role of those repeated sequences, which are the attachment of the genomic DNA to the cellular membrane, or a possible role in the partitioning of the DNA during cell division, which obviously were wrong. Of note also, this is an obscure paper from below here, an obscure paper from 1996, just to tell you that CRISPR structures have been given different names. CRISPR appeared later, so many, many different names, all defining the same features. So it's quite difficult when you are trying to get back in the literature about early papers to get them all, because names have been different, and yeah, so some difficulties here.
And then we now leapfrog all the way to the late 1990s. And what was happening at the time was a lot of different scientists in many different groups and locations in the world were continuing to sequence bacterial genomes, archaeal genomes, and repeatedly, no pun intended, they were observing those peculiar CRISPR arrays across most of the genomes that were being sequenced. And we see here yet again that, you know, still in the antiquity of CRISPR, on the cusp of the Middle Ages by now, people were using those very peculiar idiosyncratic genetic sequences to genotype pathogens of interest to medicine. And we see here perhaps the first ever paper on the Streptococcus CRISPR-Cas system.
In 2000, a very important paper came out. It was a short commentary, but it was the realization that actually those sequences found in many different genomes were composing one family of DNA repeats. So this Spanish group also found some CRISPR-like sequences in eukaryotes, and notably in mitochondria. But actually, this was also a wrong detection. So the biological role of CRISPR at that time was still unknown.
And we now leap through away from antiquity to the Middle Ages, the dark ages of CRISPR, arguably. And some CRISPR royalty like Eugene Koonin started paying more and more attention to those peculiar and idiosyncratic arrays in the genomes of about half of bacteria and 90% of archaea, and we started using bioinformatics to try to gaze into and perhaps predict the biological functions that those systems and those sequences may provide. And we went away from replicon partitioning, structure-based replicon partitioning, to analyses and through similarities between the Cas proteins, some famous and popular in hindsight two CRISPR-Cas systems that are now very relevant, and some of the conserved domains in the proteins that the Cas genes encode, led Eugene Koonin and Kira Makarova to predict that they were intimately involved in interaction with DNA and RNA. And they suggested at the time that CRISPR-Cas systems may provide an actual DNA repair pathway in the genomes of many bacteria and most archaea.
So 2002, in the middle of the Middle Ages, the Spanish group of Morica and the Dutch team who used CRISPR to do genotyping in pathogenic bacteria decided to give one name, a new name, and this was when the CRISPR term was coined. And in those two different papers, they described the repeats in one, in the first paper, and in the other one, the associated Cas genes with proposed functions for some of those genes.
This is technically when CRISPR was baptized. So if you go back to the literature and go back to the history of CRISPR, you can now start looking at actual, tangible CRISPR literature. Now, Philippe mentioned in his opening comment that some of our journey with the CRISPR-Cas system started indeed in the middle, dark ages, middle ages of CRISPR biology. And Philippe, through the great perquisite of being an industrial scientist, allowed to go to meetings where academics present their work, was introduced to a people in France using those, again, peculiar and unique loci in streptococci, Streptomophilus, vestibularis, and salivarius. And people were showing that those were very powerful genotyping tools. And this is when his journey and our journey with the CRISPR-Cas system and story started.
Yeah, so at that time, I was struggling, trying to find ways to differentiate strains from this species, which is not trivial without going to analyze the DNA. And this very species is important for DuPont as a provider of starter cultures, notably for the dairy industry, because it's the yogurt bacterium. It's also used to transform milk into some cheeses, like mozzarella. It's the only species which is grass within the Streptococcus genus. It's a special species which grows at quite high temperature, and it divides very quickly, very efficiently, and because it's also acidifying very efficiently, transforming the lactose of milk into lactic acid, this is the most important bacterium for the transformation of many different dairy products. The problem was that this species is susceptible to phage attacks. It's not an issue for DuPont as a provider of starter cultures, but it's a problem for our customers because they are fermenting huge amounts of milk. And if phages that are found naturally in the milk are present and active on the strains that we add to ferment this milk, there might be a big problem because the bacteria get killed and the acidification stops. So the milk remains milk. And this is probably the biggest cause of fermentation failure in the dairy industry. So with a big economic impact. So this is why DuPont was and is still putting a lot of effort in order to select strains that are as robust, as resistant as possible against those infection. And luckily, at that time, we were also involved in some genome sequencing projects The poster presented by INRA in 2002 described the first sequencing of a genome for this species, but the sequence was not available. And on our side, we were involved in a strain, bacterial genome sequencing, but also sequencing of phage genomes.
So this is where the story kind of switches around a little bit. And you're going to see that we were able, and like other people, to bring different pieces of the puzzle, different parts of the equation together, and piecemeal them into a story that was going to make sense. The other thing that's interesting is, if you think right now of where we were at the time, we were trying in a company, in a for-profit company selling starter cultures for the dairy industry, to address a very simple problem. How do bacteria withstand phage attack when you turn milk into yogurt or milk into cheese? And this is a good illustration of how biomedical sciences sometimes have a very interesting or unexpected nucleation point. And if you think about what you're going to hear for the next 2 days, you can also, as a consumer, if you like cheese, if you like yogurt, if you eat a cheeseburger or a pizza or nachos or cheese curds, right?
The ability in the industry to withstand phage attack. And one big part of the puzzle that it took us years to appreciate later on was to be able to have access to data that other people didn't necessarily have access to. And indeed, we were at the time, and you can see where we are. If you've been around long enough, you know those were very exciting times in genome sequencing. The genome sequencing golden age and so many things. And we were an industrial partner in a very broad project targeting at sequencing the genomes of bacteria involved in food fermentation processing.
So based on this available genome, we designed PCR primers, and we started to genotype strains from our collection, the Danisco collection at that time. We had several hundreds, if not thousands of strains to analyze. And by doing this sequencing, we obtained an outstanding data set. So you have here a representation of what we analyzed at that time. So I will zoom in this section just to explain what is displayed. So each little square here corresponds to a spacer. We do not represent the repeats because they are all the same and they are always in between two spacers. And for one given spacer sequence, there is always the same color combination that is given. It was an Excel macro that was written to transform sequences into those visual figures. And this allowed us to group strains that had similar spacer content. So for instance here, you have one group of strains. Each line corresponds to a CRISPR array from one strain. So all those strains here have identical spacers on this end of the locus. You can see here a nice separation between two different lineages that have evolved a bit differently. And on the leader end, on this side, you have a lot more variation of a little amount of spacers. Below here, you have another group that has no spacer in common to this one, so that we could really classify the strains. And we did that for several hundreds of strains. So back to this picture. On the left, you have the CRISPR-1 locus. And because the Streps thermophilus species, we told you that it's a good model. Actually, it contains up to four systems. Here, we described three. In the middle here, you have CRISPR-2, and on the right here, CRISPR-3, which is not present in all the strains. So CRISPR-1 was both present in all strains, and it showed the biggest variation in terms of spacer content, so that we used this CRISPR-1 array to really classify and identify our strains.
So if you start zooming in and trying to really understand how genetically distinct some of those groups of strains are and how they relate to one another, we now have access to a highly valuable, highly informative, short piece of DNA which contains a lot of information about the unique path of the strain. And we started observing consistently the grouping or the clustering of different groups of industrial starch cultures that were used in different environments. And you can see we have one great group here that shares common sequences, another great group here that shares common sequences, and so on and so forth. So on one end of the world, in one part of the team, people are trying to use CRISPR-Cas systems for genotyping. And elsewhere at the same time, people are trying to understand how Streptomyphilus is attacked and or is subjected to phage lysis industrially and or is sensitive or resistant to different groups of viruses. And this is when the two worlds collide. This is when the group that is responsible and involved in the sequencing of CRISPR-Cas systems for genotyping and the clustering into group 1, group 2, group 3, and group 4 has the eureka moment as the eye-opening realization that those genotypic groups, those varied groups of strains, are resistant or sensitive to different groups of bacteriophage. And that's when we have the opportunity to realize that there may be a link. Hypothetically, there may be a link between the CRISPR genotype on one end and the phage sensitivity phenotype on the other end. And this is where our story can switch gear to try to look into whether there would be a link or not between this genotype and this phenotype.
So we used a strain that we have named DGCC7710. We can say it's our white mouse in the lab at DuPont. It was a strain isolated in 1985, and this is one of the few strains that contain four CRISPR-Cas systems, and the beauty of this strain is that it contains the three major types, type 1, 2, and 3, and even further, it contains two type 2 systems, namely CRISPR-1 here and CRISPR-3. So we used this strain because we also had a lot of phages isolated on this strain, and we used the information that we got from CRISPR genotyping.
So oftentimes in the industry, when you use a strain that makes great yogurt, you want to abuse a strain that makes great yogurt. And when you do that, invariably, predictably, and inconveniently, occasionally this one great product maker would get attacked or slaughtered or inconvenienced by a local virus in a dairy manufacturing. And again, as Philippe mentioned, this strain had been commercialized in the 80s. Okay? And at some point, we were able in the lab to isolate a variant of that phage, a variant of that strain that had become resistant to a phage using a natural means. Okay? So we exposed this strain to this phage and selected a variant, a subset of the population that gained the ability to withstand the phage attack. And when we sequenced the genome, the eureka moment, the life-altering moment, the scientific discovery moment, was that in the genome of that strain that had become phage resistant, we observed the addition of new sequences. So something had changed in the genotype, specifically in the CRISPR genotype, that could correlate potentially with the phage resistance phenotype. And we then embarked on a series of experiments, for which we've been recognized today, that enabled us to test the hypothesis, very hypothesis-driven science in the industry, trying to understand whether there is a link indeed between the appearance of those new spacers in the host and the ability of the host to be vaccinated against a phage.
But at that time, the topic was heating up because in February, May, and August of this year, three papers came out proposing a role for CRISPR and the associated genes as a new mechanism of phage resistance. But all those observations were based on genome sequences and not on on biological data. It was mostly in silico comparisons.
And indeed, right, if you try to put the pieces together, just having a bioinformatic prediction, just having in silico-based insights into the function of a gene, of a genotype, or a function of a protein, only takes you so far. Now, if you go back to the actual history, the actual timeline of CRISPR-Cas system, and occasionally there's some controversies or you know, short homework on who did what, when, where, and how. It's interesting to see that all the way back to August 26, 2005, DuPont filed for the first patent, tangibly of the US Patent Office, to try to link the CRISPR-Cas system with the phage-resistant genotype in bacteria.
So based on these observations about DGCC7710, we decided to reproduce those experiments so that we called our friend and collaborator Sylvain Moineau at Université Laval in Quebec in order to help us on this topic and to do experiments independently from what we already did. So he took the same strain, he used the same phages, and it was amazing really to observe that each time surviving colonies were obtained following a phage challenge, those surviving cells contained additional spacers at the leader end of CRISPR-1. In most cases, a single spacer could explain some addition of novel phage resistance, but in some other cases, multiple spacers could be acquired. And all those events occurred at the leader end of the array. And those were experiments done by Hélène Deveau in Sylvain Moineau's lab.
So we got ourselves here with one observation in a series of experiments done in collaboration with a friend of ours, that indeed, upon becoming phage resistant, we observed the acquisition of a new set of spacers at the leader end of the locus. There's acquisition, arguably adaptive acquisition, of a new piece of DNA in the CRISPR locus upon becoming resistant. That indicates that there may be a link, circumstantial evidence, it's not quite scientific evidence as of yet, there may be a link between the two. And the first thing we did is, because we had the phage sequences and the host sequences, we just blasted them. And this tells us that all the spacers that were acquired and integrated into the CRISPR locus, all the spacers that were acquired and integrated into the CRISPR locus upon becoming resistant to those phages were derived exactly from the viral sequences that had been used in that challenge. Okay, suggesting very strongly, but still suggesting only, that there might be a link between the acquisition of those spacers from the phage and the resistance in the host. And some interesting observations here are that all the modules in the phage genome are being sampled. So we found spacers in the virus, we call them protospacers, right? All across the genome in all functional domains. And the second interesting observation is that spacers can show perfect identity to either strand of the DNA. That was the first clue towards the potential origin and the potential targeting of CRISPR-Cas immune system as double-stranded phage DNA later on. So we now have to prove that scientifically. We now have to establish this scientifically.
So we decided to use molecular biology techniques in order to really prove that the acquisition of novel spacers was the single event explaining this immunity. So we constructed a series of strains derived from DGCC7710. In the first one here, we added those two spacers, S1, S2, in the parental strain that did not have those two, and we showed that we could provide resistance. In the second experiment, we removed all the spacer content, just left one repeat, and we lost all those resistance that we had against different phages. In a third experiment, we displaced the CRISPR locus from the Cas genes, and we observed a loss of phage resistance. And finally, we did a kind of swapping experiment between two strains having different phage sensitivities. And when we swapped the spacers, we could also swap the phage resistance profile of those two strains.
So by then, we had very good scientific evidence that there was indeed a link between the CRISPR spacer content and phage resistance. But we made that observation that when you displace the CRISPR array away from the Cas genes, it doesn't work anymore. So there might be a functional link between those two things. And then secondly, especially when you're from the industry and you want to submit a paper to a journal, you have to appeal and cater to and woo the mechanism of action mafia. This is what they're called in the real world, right? And we knew we had to do something about those genes, because we knew the reviewers were going to ask, well, what do those genes do? If you have genes next to your locus, they must do something. So because we were lucky and somewhat lazy and somewhat encumbered by the potential but somewhat limited tools that we can use in lactic acid bacteria to do genome editing and engineering at the time, like before CRISPR, right? Think about that. So we came in, it's like, you know, genome editing, so like circa 2005, right? So we came in and we integrated a plasmid into the largest gene that was there. And at the time it wasn't called Cas9, but since then it'd be called Cas9, it's been called Cas5, Cas1, and CSN1. And when we inactivated this particular gene, we lost the ability to be resistant to the phage, though the spacers were there. Thus implicating essentially Cas9 into the interference stage. Because we knew the mechanism mafia was going to ask the question, we had to inactivate a second gene, so we went to the second largest gene, again, somewhat lucky and somewhat lazy. We integrated plasmid in there, and we observed that we did not lose the resistance in this particular case, right? But we lost the ability to acquire new spacer. We lost the ability to acquire new vaccination events. And this particular series of experiments essentially implicated Cas proteins, right? Cas genes and the proteins they encode into both the acquisition stage, the vaccination stage, the integration of spacers from those viruses, and the interference stage, the immunity stage, the ability to use those spacers to build resistance. And another piece that was interesting that we'll come back a little bit later is that, as Philippe said, there were multiple CRISPR-Cas systems in this genome. There were two type 2A systems in this particular genome. And when we did those knockouts, we didn't see rescue from the other system, being the first link to what we call orthogonality and the boundaries of cross-functionality between different CRISPR-Cas systems.
So in 2006, the team at NCBI, so Eugene Cronin and Kira Makarova, who described a potential role of Cas gene in DNA repair, published comprehensive. Merci. Describing the potential role of Cas genes and CRISPR, and they proposed a kind of RNAi mechanism, also explaining how new spacers could be added. This is shown here, with a particular insertion in the middle of the locus. So this was a very nice paper, important, but some aspects were still wrong in this paper.
So this is when we really leap out and away from the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages of the CRISPR world, arguably into the modern period. We're going to get into the CRISPR Renaissance by then, right? And we can now piece those various elements of the puzzle together, the bioinformatics, the phage biology, the host biology. We had collaborators that focus on phages. We had people come in that are going to focus on biochemistry and others. And this is when we got the great privilege to publish this paper, right, which remained the most cited CRISPR paper until some of our co-laureates kind of came in and did much bigger science, right? But one of the great perquisites thereof in terms of puzzle is that when this paper came out, we got in touch with great collaborators that enabled us over the last decade, right? This is so 2007. Over the last decade to advance the field and to bring new perspectives, new ideas, new technologies, new vantage points to address different questions and essentially build up the CRISPR puzzle over the past decade.
So the next important discovery that we did in collaboration with Sylvain, and this is also something that Hélène Devaux observed by analyzing mutant phages, was the existence and importance of the PAM. So PAM means protospacer adjacent motif. So this has been determined by analyzing mutant phages, so phages that mutated in order to escape the CRISPR-based immunity. So those phages could be isolated, and we sequenced them. It was done in Sylvain Moineau lab. And for many of those mutant phages, we could observe one mutation, a single SNP, within the sequence in the phage genome that is targeted by the spacer. But in most of those mutant phages, the mutation was present outside of this sequence. So it was an adjacent sequence, and we then realized that this sequence was conserved, always adjacent to sequences targeted by novel spacers. And so that we published this discovery in a Journal of Bacteriology.
And if you are a fan of CRISPR history, right, you can tell some of those who are in the audience here, right? We initially called this the CRISPR motif. It was scientifically correct, but not very sexy, right? And then Francisco Mojica came back with a Spanish flair and called it the PAM, L-PAM for protospacer adjacent motif. And it's another example of how over time things get renamed. CRISPR, again, didn't get baptized until 2002. Though discovered originally in 1987, and then Cas9 didn't get renamed until 2011 with a new nomenclature, though we had had different names over time before. To go back to the orthogonality thing we mentioned a few minutes ago, again, we are lucky enough to have a genome with multiple CRISPR-Cas systems, four in total, one type 1, one type 3, and two type 2s, and we can now try to compare and contrast those systems. Again, so Cas9 at the time is called Cas5. And we can see that level of diversity is fairly sizable at the protein level, right? Identity and similarities from an amino acid standpoint. And we can tell that the repeats are different, and we can tell that the PAMs are different. And we start gaining some insights into the various elements that that comprise CRISPR-Cas system that make them unique, including the effector molecules that carry out the processes biochemically, including the DNA repeats that by definition are the CRISPRs, and then the PAM motifs that enable them to function.
In 2008, an important paper was also published in Science describing the effectors of the CRISPR-Cas system. So this work was done in E. coli by the team of John van der Oost, and they showed that the CRISPR effectors for the immunity were short RNA molecules. And so then at that time, the system was an RNA-based, probably DNA-targeting system.
And again, if you guys were in the CRISPR world almost 10 years ago, we didn't get 10 CRISPR papers in the news every day, right? We had one CRISPR paper every few months. And it was amazing to see at the time, right, the Renaissance period within the modern period, for those who take history lesson at the U of T, right, this is the Renaissance right here. Within a few months, people see that indeed it is RNA-mediated DNA-targeting adaptive immunity. And Luciano Marafini and Eric Sontheimer published this excellent and outstanding paper showing that indeed in this particular case in a type 3 system, the target is DNA. So between 2007 and the summer of 2008, you have three papers coming back to back to back establishing unequivocally that CRISPR-Cas provide adaptive immunity in bacteria through a DNA-encoded, RNA-mediated DNA targeting system and establish immunity.
So DNA as a target became very quickly the dogma, but in 2009, Michael Tern's team published a paper showing that in type 3 system, the target molecule could be RNA. So this was a big shift in how we imagined that CRISPR-Cas were working. And so this is partly explained by the big diversity of CRISPR-Cas systems. There were no reasons why these systems could not target either DNA or RNA.
So there we found ourselves in the industry trying to understand how CRISPR-Cas systems work. And we knew that the better we understand them, the more easily we're going to be able to co-opt them from a scientific standpoint, technological standpoint, and industrial standpoint. So we're not sure right then whether it's DNA targeting, whether it's RNA targeting, whether it's a type 1 or type 2 or type 3, CSM, CMR, CSN1, and Cas9. So in one of our critical efforts and projects with Sivan 1.0, we started to understand how CRISPR-Cas systems work in Streptomophilus and what they do to viral DNA, right? So we had the fortuitous, excellent observation that when you sequence phage DNA during a phage infection in the host, we observe that we actually see, from a sequence standpoint, very clear, blunt DNA cleavage, three nucleotides away from the 3' edge of the protospacer. So we have the spacer sequence here in blue in the CRISPR. We have the CRISPR motif, right? CRISPR motif now, the PAM, two nucleotides away. There, it's AGAW oftentimes. And Sylvain, together with us, was able to show that if you count back one, two, and three nucleotides, you can generate a blunt DNA cleavage, blunt dsDNA cleavage, in the genome of phages that are infectious to bacteria. He did the same thing, and we did the same thing with plasmids, because we knew that some of the spacers came from plasmids. And invariably, and predictably, and accurately, and surgically, right, we could tell that in all of the elements and variants that had acquired spacers against plasmids, we could observe a cleavage exactly three nucleotides away from the 3' edge of the protospacer, immediately adjacent to the PAM. And again, the PAM in that particular case is NNAGAAW.
I will not enter into the detail of those experiments. The idea was to test using DNA-DNA hybridization how the DNA was cleaved in plasmid DNA or phage DNA. So we used several probes to determine that. And what we did also was to inactivate Cas9, at that time called Cas5. And what is interesting here is that when the Cas9 gene is disrupted, there is no cleavage anymore, confirming that Cas9 was indeed involved in the cleavage of the target DNA.
So oftentimes scientists like to work with their favorite organism, and only a select few people like us like to work with Streptomophilus. So one of our dear friends and colleagues, Virgi Sixnis, decided that he would take the CRISPR locus, okay, and some pieces that were characterized only thereafter, you'll hear about those from Emmanuel's talk, right? You could take this CRISPR locus, in this case CRISPR-3 against type 2 system with the Cas9, and then transfer it onto a plasmid and transform that plasmid into E. coli. And again, circa 2011, it was a big leap to take a CRISPR system, transfer it, reprogram it, redirect it, and rewrite its targeting. And we showed in a series of experiments that you could reprogram the CRISPR spacers to target plasmid DNA into E. coli and preclude DNA uptake. And we also showed that you could reprogram this system to target lambda sequences and essentially vaccinate by engineering and heterologous transfer E. coli against phage lambda using a Streptomyphilus type 2 system.
In following studies with the VRG6-ness in Lithuania, we characterized also the fact that the two strains of the target DNA are cleaved by different active sites in Cas9. And at that time, it provided a way to divert Cas9 on the small interfering RNA in order to have a programmed cleavage of DNA.
So we leap now, you know, out of the modern period into some of the material that our fellow laureates will cover extensively and in detail. So we will stop our contributions right here. We hope that you have a much better appreciation of the long history of CRISPR-Cas system, beyond just the past 3 years. And we'll leave it to Jennifer in order, Jennifer, Emmanuel, certainly Fong, to walk you through how we leap out of the modern period into the contemporary period of CRISPR and arguably the contemporary period of medicine.
So now we move to some applications of the CRISPR-Cas systems, and so there are many different things, obviously genome editing, but we will present a few applications in bacteria that are of importance for most of them to DuPont. So the first one is obviously the genotyping that we can do while amplifying and sequencing CRISPR regions. We had the pleasure to develop some Excel-based tools that helped us a lot to do this analysis. And this typing was successfully applied to a large number of species, not only food bacteria, but also bacteria of medical importance, such as E. coli, Salmonella, and a lot of others. The most important application to us in DuPont is the possibility to do vaccination, and this is a process that we have called CRISPRization. So it's very simple. We are starting from a sensitive strain. We are using one phage that is active, lytic on this strain, and we let nature do the job. Because we are then selecting survivors that we analyze by sequencing CRISPR loci. And in most cases, following a phage challenge, we can isolate strains that have novel spacers in one or multiple CRISPR loci. And those spacers provide resistance against the phage used in the challenge. This phage cannot be used anymore because the strain is resistant. So if we are lucky, we have in collection other phages that are still active on this new variant, and we can start this process again and again until we get at the end of the process where no known phage is able to infect the final variant. In this situation here, we have a variant that has acquired a lot of novel spacers. It is resistant to all the phages that we know, and we hope being able to have a robustness that is increased in dairy fermentations.
Now, if you think about this for a minute, not as a scientist, however hard as it may be, but as a consumer, right? This natural process of CRISPRization of dairy cultures that is natural has been implemented in the industry for 5 years. So think about whether people consume a bite of yogurt or a cheeseburger or one bite of poutine at some point in the past 5 years, one slice of cheese that's not homemade. Ponder where that stuff comes from locally, whether you're in China, whether you're in Saskatchewan or Newfoundland, or even in the US. Now, over time, as Philippe mentioned, there are iterative ways to vaccinate those bacteria against viruses. And the order in which you expose a strain to a phage is determined by the scientist. So when you have a bank of phages of different types, let's say the yellow phage first, then the blue, you acquire a yellow, then a blue DNA piece of data, and then you can go to, you know, pink or Canadian red, you can go to green or orange. And over time, when you have this vaccination card, this historical record in DNA of vaccination events, you end up with a very unique fingerprint. That fingerprint can be used to readily detect, type, and tag the genomes of any bacterium of interest, of industrial interest, of medical interest, that you may be interested in.
So this application especially has been patented, and this is very useful to DuPont because we are able to do genetic labeling of our strains in a non-GMO way, because it's natural. We are using phages to do that. And this is critical to us because we can then track and follow our strains as we use them and sell them.
And this is so 2006, by the way. Okay, so another way to use CRISPR-Cas systems is to direct the CRISPR-Cas machinery towards self. And as some other people have shown, you can do genome editing. We'll hear about that quite a bit today and tomorrow. But occasionally, what you can do is try to target various species of DNA in the genomes of bacteria. And you can map essential genes, because if you target an essential gene and you cut the genome, the bacterium is not going to make it. But occasionally, we can unearth, we can detect, we can find very rare, very infrequent events that occur in a mixed population of bacteria. And we can identify pieces of DNA that naturally pop out at a very low frequency. So when you make yogurt, when you make cheese, when you grow Streptomyphilus, they go very, very, very high numbers, right? Very high densities.
And if you use CRISPR to target non-essential pieces, we can see expendable genomic islands pop out.
And in this particular case, it's one way to evolve genomes of bacteria naturally and screen for events that sometimes are very dramatic. So we showed you can, for example, cut out 100 kb out of a 1.96 meg genome, and you can naturally cut out 5% of a genome in one step. Okay. Likewise, as originally shown in 2008, you can use that to target phages. And phages will escape the CRISPR-Cas system and mutate their PAM. They will mutate their protospacer. They will delete their PAM or their protospacer, essentially do natural genome editing. So you can work on the interplay and the ongoing warfare between phages and bacteria at the genomic level. Now, when you actually target bacteria, this event is very lethal. And one very cool, interesting, intriguing, and rising application of CRISPR-Cas systems is that when you go into E. coli and you use a type 1 system that's more damaging, regardless of the location in the genome that you target, whether it's coding, non-coding, heavily transcribed, not heavily transcribed, essential, non-essential, you're going to kill 99.999% of every cell population when you have a single spacer. So imagine what you can do with multiple spacers. And the specificity with which you define that target can be defined by the user. So we showed you can take two E. coli strains that are nearly identical, nearly clonal, right, 99.9% identical, and use this 0.1% difference to selectively target and kill one genotype or the other genotype or both genotypes. Conversely, you can modulate that down and then take E. coli and Salmonella that are 71.8% identical and then eradicate just E. coli, just Salmonella, or both, opening the doors for sequence-specific antimicrobials and microbiome engineering. I'll let you think about that.
So applications in the domain of the food industry go beyond bacteria. The genome editing tool based on Cas9 and other CRISPR-derived elements is currently applied to many different organisms. And obviously, it's very important in agriculture, and in that field, DuPont Pioneer is a big user of Cas9 in order to improve crops, notably. And in several of those applications, what is interesting is that there is no foreign DNA that needs to be added. And this is important for GMO versus non-GMO uses.
Right. So in many ways, we hope that you appreciate that, you know, CRISPR wasn't born and raised and developed, you know, in 2013, and that some of the history goes back all the way. Okay, 1987, it was born. 2002, it was baptized. It has its adolescent tumultuous years coming out of the dark ages into adulthood eventually, right? And at the same time, you can start rebuilding not just the timelines based upon what papers have been published, but also the timelines at DuPont, going back 15 years almost, over when patents were applied for. The typing in 2004, the antiviral in 2005, the tagging of bacteria in 2006, and broad-scale phage resistance in 2007.
So I think that the reason why we were the first to be able to provide those demonstrations was that we had at hand the right ingredients. We had many pieces of the puzzle, and so we had the right model, I think, Streptococcus thermophilus. We had a big collection of strains and phages. We had access to sequences. We had the right people to analyze this data. We had the right collaborators. And it was also perhaps a lucky timing, because we knew later that some others have submitted papers to Science, and ours was selected because we provided some biology. And obviously, we were also very lucky to have this 7710 strain as our model system.
So if you look back at the history of CRISPR that we shared with you this morning, I think it's important to just take a moment and kind of look back upon how impactful this CRISPR decade has been. You know, for us, we've published, you know, combined about 80 papers in the field, and we've seen the pace and the scale at which CRISPR has been democratized, right? When we gave our first talk, the whole literature was 27 papers. And within one PhD cycle, it went to one paper a month, to one paper a week, to one paper a day, to multiple papers every day right now. It's unbelievable. And then this scientific democratization has also spilled out into the media, right? People doing TV shows about CRISPR, CRISPR making the cover of The Economist and Time magazine, and, you know, scientists being in Forbes and the Wall Street Journal. It's fantastic. And this is a good example of how industry actually can accelerate, can harness powerful technologies to move the field ahead in biotechnology, in ag, in food, in medicine, and gene therapies. And you can see across different business segments, and within each business segment, large companies, small cap companies, not-for-profit companies like Agene, and startup companies join the community. And I think that's one thing that we hope that we illustrated today, was that the way big science works and the way big discoveries work, though we're delighted to share the prize together, is a community-based effort. What you'll hear today, what you'll hear tomorrow, is a big community of CRISPR scientists that come from different vantage points, bring different pieces to that puzzle, and advance science. Now, some of the interesting things that for the students maybe would be relevant is that just doing the in silico prediction is not enough. Just trying to guess what the function may be, occasionally you're going to be right, sometimes, maybe oftentimes you will be wrong. And we've seen that happen, you know, just before the role was established. And we've seen that happen just before the proof of concept for genome editing very critically was established in human cell by Fongs. And then also it's a good reminder that sometimes if you really want to get the real literature, the vintage literature, right? Just doing a text word search is not going to be enough. You have to go back, you have to read, you have to dig in, and we hope that you are going to do that over time. Now, in closing, what we wanted to say is, can we predict right? Can we predict the future and not just revisit the past? So we hope that people will keep calm and CRISPR on, right? And the science will turn into greater technologies and greater applications. And I think a lot of people here and in the world are very excited about gene therapies. We're going to hear about that over the next 2 days. As Philippe mentioned, you know, there's a very strong momentum in ag, you know, food and crops, you know, plants and animals. In a back to the future moment, the CRISPR antiviral in bacteria is being repurposed as a CRISPR antiviral in eukaryotes, and we'll hear about that and people working on that that are receiving awards this year. And then likewise, we're very confident that more people are going to try to unravel mysterious dark matter in the genome and move that forward. Okay? But however good the things may be, what CRISPR giveth, you know, others might taketh. And we have the drama about the IP and the sensitivities of the PR and GMO, non-GMO, and regulatory pathways and ethics. And we'll hear again over the next 2 days, this is where you'll be back to make sure that you understand the shortcomings from a scientific standpoint.
So with that, I would like to thank the many contributors to those discoveries, and notably people in DuPont. In France, I would like to mention Christophe Remeau, Anne-Claire, Florian, Florence, Isabelle and Max, who contributed. You know, these are the little hands in the labs that never appear in the papers, but that do the job. And I would also like to mention Dennis Romero from Madison. Patrick. And Patrick Boyaval in France, DuPont.
And then I'm going to acknowledge my former colleagues at DuPont, you know, Philippe and all the aforementioned people that have been our partners in crime and the hands in the lab and the heads of the computers. I'd like to thank my lab at NC State, the CRISPR lab, and some of our collaborators. Sylvain has been mentioned many a time, Jill Benfield, and Virgil Sixness. We're going to disclose some conflicts of interest. So I'm a former employee at DuPont. I've been serving on the board of Caribou for 3 years. I'm a co-founder and SAB member for Intellia and co-founder and SAB member for Locus. And Philippe is still a DuPont employee.
Yes.
There's been a lot of funding from DuPont and NC State and all the aforementioned pieces here. And the many people with which and with whom we've been able to share that journey. People like Jennifer, people like Eric Sontheimer, people like Luciano Marafini. And it's been very pleasant, very fun, very hectic, very dramatic, but very enjoyable to share this journey. And we're extremely thankful to the Gairdner Foundation for recognizing some of our work. And we also like to congratulate our fellow laureates for sharing the discoveries with us. Well, thank you for your
time. Thanks a lot.